Hey everyone, Mr. Happy here, and today we are going to talk about Eureka. With the third zone, Pyros, being one of my favorites, and I've had a lot of positive things to say about it, it seems I've seen more and more people looking at Eureka and going, maybe I should have kept up with that, just in case. As such, plenty of people have been asking me, is it too late to get caught up, and if I can still get caught up, how do I do it? So fortunately, the answers to these questions are pretty easy, so I wanted to make a video on it. First, I'll just tackle the most major question. Is it too late to get caught up? Like most of Final Fantasy XIV, catching up is never terribly difficult, and in fact it gradually gets easier over time. Eureka is not any different, seeing constant buffs and adjustments over the patches to make sure that this is possible. While there are stretches of Eureka that are more tedious than others, it's far from insurmountable. One of my biggest recommendations is to play during peak hours for your data center, such as after work or on weekends. Tuesdays can also be busy since people often cap tombstones in Eureka, especially in Onimos. However, that's not sufficient to get you caught up, so let's look at the first two zones, Onimos and Pagos, and talk about what your goal should be as you're going through these areas. First up, we have Onimos. You can unlock access to the zone once you finish the 4.0 main scenario quest, Stormblood, and you must be level 70 to enter. It also has an item level sync of 300, so maybe grab some tombstone gear just for a little boost before hopping in. Then head to the NPC Rodney in Kugane and start your journey through Eureka. Onimos sets the tone for the most basic things you'll need to understand in all of the Eureka zones we have so far. Finish your relic weapon steps introduced, and complete the story quest in that zone. It will also teach you the basic concepts of things such as the Magia Board throughout the story quests, a wheel that allows you to elementally align your character to improve your offense and defense against different enemies. When you target an enemy, a sword on the Magia board means the enemy is weak to that element, while a shield means you will take less damage using that element when you receive attacks. You can only place Magicite after earning it from the story quests in Onimos, and only while in the base camp at the entrance. You may spin the wheel while you're anywhere to adjust it based on the enemy you're fighting, though you can only save modifications up to 5 times in a short time frame. This number gradually goes back up as time passes, and often it's never really much a factor. This number gradually goes back up as time passes, so the limit on how many times you're available to spin it normally doesn't matter. Another basic thing that Onimos teaches you is that Eureka has its own leveling system called elemental levels, which you can increase by killing enemies and bosses. Level differences make a huge difference in terms of your fighting strength, so be careful on what you aggro or decide to pick a fight with. Onimos also has a level cap of 20, while Pagos, the second zone, has a level cap of 35. Pyros, the third zone, which we won't talk about much here, has a level cap of 50. Also, you won't have access to your personal mount until you progress far enough in the story in Onimos, after the level 17 quest. The Aetherites will become entirely obtainable once you reach level 9, though you will have to attune to them, and you can only teleport between them when interacting with them, so be careful when you're navigating early on. If someone in your party has a two-seater, see if they'll let you hitch a ride. As for completing the relic weapon steps, this is mostly done by killing notorious monsters around the map, which spawn as players kill select enemies in the boss's area. In the description of this video, you'll find the Eureka Tracker website. This allows players to make sheets to track death timers and weather conditions based on info inputted by the user, and also has a map option to give you everything you need to know about the enemies, their levels, and the bosses of the area. The maps even have quest locations to help with those story quests we mentioned earlier, since those locations don't get marked on your map once you accept the quest. Anyway, these NMs drop EXP, tombstones, and Onimos crystals. These Onimos crystals can be exchanged for protean crystals at Geralt back in the base camp, and you'll need plenty proteans. In Onimos, most players just run around the map in a giant ball, spawning notorious monster after notorious monster as a group. Even lower level players often just follow this train along into the more dangerous areas to keep the flow of EXP constant. That being said, one of the first things you'll want to make sure you're doing is your challenge log. This requires you to kill enemies of various elements and types, such as fire enemies or undead, Ashkin as it calls them. This log resets weekly and provides a massive EXP bonus, so make sure to get this done every week while you're catching up. Also, try to do some of them right when you enter Onimos for the first time to get a few levels under your belt. In total, you'll need 1,300 protean crystals and 3 Pazuzu feathers, which can be obtained from the NM of the same name, or by trading an extra 300 protean crystals per feather to the Birdwatcher NPC. You also need the antiquated weapon from your level 70 job quest, either from the coffer or repurchased at the Calamity Salvager if you already tossed it. This will eventually power the weapon up to item level 355 when you are done upgrading it here. If you want to take a little side venture, you can also upgrade the antiquated armor from the same sources to item level 350. That's really only if you need armor for non-Eureka activities, and this will cost you more Protean and Onimos crystals, extending your stay in the zone. So once you finish the relic weapon in Onimos and you've completed all the quests, hit level 20, you're all set. Go outside, speak to Rodney again, and you'll be able to unlock Pagos or Pagos, the second zone. Now to be honest, while you can start going there before level 20 and you can start going there at level 20, a lot of people prefer to stay in Onimos until 25. Pagos is a much harsher zone to navigate, to reach the boss areas, and usually has less items spawning overall. Therefore, it's not uncommon to stay in Onimos for the first few levels just to get yourself a little bit of growing space before heading out into Pagos. In Pagos, your goals are somewhat similar to Onimos. Finish the relic steps and the story. You'll lose access to your mount again until completing the level 35 quest, and the Aetherite level ranges are much stricter in Pagos. The first one is east of the base camp, and it's only elemental level 21, while the northwest one is level 30, and the northeast one is level 32. Until then, there is only one narrow corridor to give you access to the northern half of the map, so reaching notorious monsters up there can be super risky without friends nearby. Navigating isn't just worse because of level restrictions on transportation either. Enemies here can get in the way much more easily, and there are now sleeping dragons standing in the way of the various choke points throughout the map, including the only one that lets you go to the northern part. If you didn't know already, it's probably a good time to discuss different aggro types in Eureka. Now this isn't just true in Eureka, but it's definitely more pronounced. Different monsters will only aggro players in Eureka based on certain conditions. For one, being two or more levels over a monster will prevent it from aggroing you. Being only one level or over, or anything lower than that, and you're going to be monster food. Second, monsters have four aggro types that can make them pounce on you: sight, sound, magic, and blood. Sight aggro means that walking in front of an enemy will cause them to attack you. This usually applies to anything with eyes, literally. Sound aggro means that making too much sound, such as running or sprinting past something, will cause them to attack you. Using the walk toggle should help with this, though I'd also de-summon pets of any kind, as they are still likely to draw the monster's attention even if you are walking. Sound aggro usually applies to anything without eyes, as well as those sleeping dragons we mentioned earlier. Magic aggro means casting a spell near this type of enemy will cause them to attack. This is used almost exclusively by sprites. Finally, blood aggro means missing a large portion of your health will attract the beasties, and this only applies to anything undead. Knowing what aggros helps a lot with navigating Eureka. It becomes more vital once you've entered Pagos. There is also a somewhat hidden fifth type of aggro called touch aggro, at least that's the nickname I've given it. This is a phenomenon where an enemy that shouldn't be aggroing you, whether it's because it's sound aggro and you're walking, or it's magic aggro and you're just walking past it as well, suddenly just decides it wants to eat you for lunch. And I've only seen this happen when I'm like walking right through something's hitbox. Just try to avoid getting too close to any enemy, even if you are following all the rules. With that in mind, completing your Pagos relic is somewhat similar to Onimos. Collect Pagos crystals and Lui ice, an item similar to Pazuzu feathers, through this zone's final boss. They can also be purchased with additional Pagos crystals if you find yourself unable to get them to spawn at that Birdwatcher NPC, this time in Pagos. There is one new step introduced after the level 25 story quest though, the Pagos Kettle. This kettle collects light from enemies you kill and stores it into frosted Protean crystals. These can be collected at a furnace only accessible by dropping from the northwest cliffside onto a lower cliff and then walking past the sleeping dragon. Light is obtained under various conditions, though all involve combat. Adapted and mutated mobs provide guaranteed light, though any monster equal to or higher than your level has a chance to provide light as well. This is bolstered when landing killing blows during any chain that is a multiple of 5. Keep in mind that if you're in a party, you'll want to keep level ranges close to provide decent light and experience from casual enemies. Notorious monsters also provide decent light, and for most people, this is how they go about accruing the resource. The elemental conflicts will not provide light, though I did post a video on a trick to use them in dead instances to gain light in other ways. In total, you'll need 31 of these frosted Protean crystals in addition to several Pagos crystals and Lui ice, so as soon as you're 25, make sure to gain access to that kettle and to empty it out anytime it hits 8 or 9 crystals. That way you don't have to worry about overflowing and missing out on some light. Once you've hit 35 and upgraded your relic all the way through the Pagos steps and done all the story quests, you'll now have access to Pyros, the latest zone. We know that a fourth zone, Hydatos, or Hydatos, will become available sometime in the patch 4.5x series, and that's going to be the final zone of all of Eureka. Also, for Pyros, unlike the transition from Anemos to Paphos, you'll actually want to enter Pyros as soon as you can, as the resources you need to farm in this zone are available right from the get-go. So to keep the video length down, we'll cover Pyros more in a follow-up video. I mostly just wanted to get people acclimated to both Anemos and Paphos in this video. I do have a few additional tips, though. For one, even when playing during peak hours, sometimes the game just throws you into what's known as a dying or dead instance. This means the game has stopped placing new players into that instance sometime after you've entered, so as players leave, more players do not replace them. If this happens, you can sometimes get trapped in that instance for a while, even if you keep exiting and re-entering. You can try to keep doing that anyway to see if it throws you into something else, or you can take this opportunity to utilize the dead instance to get challenge logs done or solo light farming if you're doing it in Paphos. You'll ideally want to be placed in a fresh instance, where nothing has been killed and players are shoved into it as they queue up. Second, you lose experience points in here if you die and aren't resurrected. This is a super important aspect. You can even lose levels after getting to level 10, so it is in your best interest to stay near other players, travel in packs, and shout for raises if something has happened to you. Also, be sure to assist anyone else who might be in a situation like this. They're not going to look out for you if you don't look out for them. Third, I'd highly recommend going as a job that can utilize raises sometime throughout Eureka, especially throughout the first two zones. A lot of the times you'll be traveling to fight bosses that are a way higher level than you, and thus your damage contributions are negligible at best. Your best contribution is usually making sure that the people who are adequately leveled stay alive, so make sure to hit the boss, you know, when you got spare time, and otherwise look after everyone else in the party, whether that's through direct healing, buffs, or resurrecting people. Finally, there are other items and occurrences in Eureka to earn to help you progress. Lockboxes give tons of materia and glamour items, but they also reward potions and, in Paphos, materials to make a potion of harmony. Eurekan potions that are earned are great personal healing tools that can be purchased in the base camp as well. Potions of harmony must be crafted and increase the amount of experience points you get from monsters by 10%. You might be able to find some of these on the market board, and they're usually worth picking up as long as they're not too expensive and you got some money to throw away. And of course, elementals that spawn randomly around the map grant you a damage and EXP buff, as well as gradually restoring health over time. These are not the same as sprites. These elementals are very clearly different, and when you walk near them, they'll actually spawn a buff that hits everyone in that range. Keeping this buff up helps speed up the process, especially in conjunction with the previously mentioned items. And that's going to be a wrap for my video on getting caught up in Eureka. Apologies if I sounded a little sick throughout this. I think I just needed to grab a little bit of water, but decided to finish the recording before I went to do that. Anyway, be on the lookout for my Pyros video that's going to be coming soon. Thank you for watching this video. Be sure to like, favorite, subscribe, and share. And stay tuned. We'll have more information about Eureka, especially some super special tricks in Pyros that'll make you wonder, why weren't all the zones like this? Anyway, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Until then, take care.